A science experiment gone terribly wrong. Here's what's coming up on the Nice Guys on Business.
So social media really is that word of mouth bridging people from all around the world. But if you don't have a good brand to start with, you're kind of, in essence, putting your foot in your mouth if you don't have a good brand or creating a barrier, so to speak.
You know, she turned the Nice Guys on Business into newts. Well, they got better.
Need an education on how to grow your business? The Nice Guys are here to help. Learn about great customer service, networking, and how just being nice can help you prosper. Now, here are your hosts, Doug Sandler and Strickland Bonner.
Welcome back, Funkin' fans. It's Wednesday. It is hump day. My name is Strickland Bonner. On the other side of the microphone, Mr. Doug Sandler, and we got a fired up interview today.
This is Francis Reimers, isn't it?
It is.
I tested you every once in a while. I throw this. You know what? I not only tested you with remembering who the interview was, but I really think I tested you with the editing of this episode as well. Completely my fault. It did not sound like it was a great connection, and true to form, it was a horrible connection, and nothing to do with Francis, but all to do with, I guess, the gerbil wasn't running fast enough for my computer.
So, the internet gerbil.
Strick, how the internet gerbil, right? How have you found the editing? I really wanted to keep you on your toes with this episode. You did pretty well, though. It sounds good.
I got to be honest. As of the recording of this, I haven't actually done the editing, so I'll probably be cursing you later tonight.
all good. So, Nice Guy community, if you continue to hear in the background the girl from Ipanema and you can't find us on YouTube, it's because we have been banned from YouTube for this. Strick, that's been like four or five times now you've gotten us banned from YouTube because of, well, I guess it's my fault too.
That means somebody's paying attention. That's good.
Do you think they pay attention to that, or do you think it's like a robot that figures it
no,
out?
No, it's definitely a robot, but it feels good that they're actually, that it seems like they're paying attention, even though it's really just a robot paying attention.
Well, Frances has this, I think it's on YouTube, or no, I don't know if it's on YouTube or if she has her own personal TV station, but she has a video show called Let's Talk Personal. Pretty cool. She's got some great guests that come on the show. They banter back and forth about branding, about marketing, about exactly how to make sure that your brand is differentiated from all your competition. And Frances actually came to us. Do you remember, I don't know how many episodes back, but we had Jen Heck from the Dating Advisory Board.
Oh, sure. Yeah, she was entertaining. Yeah,
they get into total shenanigans when Jen is a guest on her show. They're very similar to us in lady form. They are they're drinking and laughing and joking on the show. I didn't know how to say that politely. I mean, they were partying pretty good on the show. But only as ladies would party on a show. You know, she's got her rosé all day. Anyway, let's get to the interview.
Did you want to talk about Overcast before we get to the interview?
Oh yeah, thanks. Yeah, if you were now, it's getting crazy now. 93-94% actually of our listeners are listening through Overcast. Not because we're losing any iTunes listeners, but because we are gaining momentum with our Overcast audience. We appreciate so very much you listening on Overcast. If you could just do us one additional favor and recommend the episodes that you're listening to, the way to do that is very simple. Right next to the play button, there is a star to the left of it. Just hit the star button. You can go back a whole bunch of episodes and recommend those as well. And that is only using the Overcast app. If you're using iTunes, just come on over to Overcast. It doesn't matter anymore about iTunes. I give them instructions, but there's for the two of you, just call me. I'll tell you how to do it. Gosh, can you believe how many, you know, we are now probably about 40 days away from episode number, probably somewhere
download around 1 million, not episode.
Oh,
1
yeah.
Million.
Oh, jeez. I keep saying that. Sorry. From download number 1 million. So we are extremely painstakingly close.
Mm-hmm.
We're almost there.
That's crazy.
Well, we're almost there, Strick.
It's a lot. What's of downloads.
Happen?
It's a big number.
What's going to happen when we hit a million?
Nothing special.
Nothing.
I mean, we'll feel special, but, you know, nothing special.
Should we stop? I mean, at that point, should we just stop?
No, I think we're doing okay.
We could prepare everybody for it. I mean, if we're going to do it, should we just prepare everybody for us stopping?
No, I don't think so. I think we need to continue. We're just finally actually getting some traction. Why would we want to quit?
I know. It's very true. It's very true. Lou and I talk about that on the show a little bit as well, just the craziness of the momentum game and Strickland and his flywheel philosophy.
Yeah, exactly.
Yeah. All right. Let's get to the wait a minute. That was Monday's interview.
What? No, Lou was Monday. Today is Francis.
Sorry, Francis. Ah, shit. This is a whole shit show. Let's just get to the interview. Francis Reimers here on the Nice Guys on Business podcast. Especially in today's social media game, your brand it's ultra important. Not only do you need to grow it, but protecting it is critical as well. Reputation, trustworthiness, your bottom line, these are the things that are on the line. So Francis Reimers, she knows the drill. As founder of Firestarter, she's here to chat some Nice Guys sense. Welcome, Francis, to the Nice Guys on Business podcast.
Hi, thank you for having me.
I love. I'll start right here with you because I know that we did a lot of technical stuff in the buildup of this show. So I apologize for the brain drain of all of that. But love the videos that I've seen. And my understanding is that it's not just on YouTube. This is a station that you're appearing on? Where's your show?
So I broadcast my show, Let's Talk Personal, from the WLVS studio, which is located on Georgia Avenue in Washington, D.C. So I come in there and the amazing guys and gals that work there help me look as best as I can.
Yeah, Francis, I have absolutely no staff, and nobody comes to make me look good, so that's why I pretty much look shitty all day long, every day that I've done this podcast, 400 bazillion episodes later. So
let me be clear, it takes a village. It takes a village for me. It really does.
Yeah, yeah. So a question for you. We're called the Nice Guys on Business. In your estimation, what does the market think of the Nice Guys? Do we have any reputation that the brand is worth protecting?
You know, it's very funny. Interesting. You have a lot of brand equity. I love the idea of there being nice guys. In business, because then I can assure you, as a entrepreneurial businesswoman, there are a lot of not nice guys in business, and so it's refreshing to see folks that are putting themselves out there in that way. And your brand equity is strong in that you are giving people tips to help make their business better, and not just tips that would be great if they had somebody else to do it for them, but actual tangible things that your listeners can walk away with and implement into their life, which just reinforces your brand all the more.
So I'll take that as the market thinks the Nice Guys brand is good.
Yes. Yes.
I'm going to take that. So help me for a second, because I think oftentimes we have trouble as a public, we have trouble tying our brand back to our bottom line. Sometimes I think there might be a disconnect that the stuff that I'm actually putting out there to the world, whether it's content through podcasting or social media, that may not necessarily be tied to the bottom line. So can you put the connection together between your brand and your bottom line?
Yeah. Well, let me first be clear that I'm a big believer that content builds relationships. The relationships improve the bottom line. And when you put content out there that is interesting, unique, immediately useful, personalized to the target audience, that is going to bring people into you, into your product, into your company, into you as an individual, that will allow you to start building relationships that will then convert into sales. I'm not a believer that content leads to direct sales, and I'm all about the relationship, because you just don't want it to be a one-time transaction. You want this person to come back, or this organization to come back to you time and time again. And you being a thought leader and creating content that is useful in people's lives, in their businesses, allows that relationship, which then will eventually add to your bottom line.
I love it. I love it. So what you're saying is that content isn't what creates your brand. It's the relationship that's going to create your brand. But in today's social media, in the new media that's out there, there is it really is hard. It's, I mean, such a fuzzy line. So help me understand what the difference between building a relationship is and just throwing content out there into the world. I mean, it sounds like to me that content is more like broadcasting and the relationship is the two-way communication going on. Is that fair, or is it go beyond that?
It goes a little beyond that. You know, what I like to advise all my clients, whether they are a celebrity or a business or, you know, a nonprofit, whatever the case may be, it's creating that balance in between broadcasting and educating. As you can see on my Instagram account, for example, there's a lot of broadcasting, you know, this appearance, for example, other appearances that I do, fun things I do in my personal time. But there's also a large amount of education, blog posts, video posts, giving people actual tips that they can take and run with themselves. I'm a big believer that brand is built best by the person who it's coming from. Yes, of course, you can hire people like me to assist you, but you have to participate. The ideas have to come from you. Somebody can't sit in a vacuum and create you for you. And so there has to be an authenticity there. And the authenticity can be seen in a broadcasting form and in an educational form, but I really do think you need the balance of both to build that relationship. You know, brand building in a social media world is the word of mouth marketing 2.0. People want to do business with people that they know. And in this world of where we are constantly on the go, the hustle and bustle, social media provides a platform to be a conduit for people to get to know you who may never actually meet you in real life. Just yesterday, I got an email from a gentleman that is all the way in San Diego who I never have met. We have no connections between friends or colleagues. And he simply saw my work on Instagram and Twitter and reached out and said, I would like to work with you. Now, in the real world, I probably would have never met this man. But because he saw my work and was able to work with me in that capacity, he was able to see my product, able to build a relationship with me, if you will, and for us to do business together. So social media really is that word of mouth bridging people from all around the world. But if you don't have a good brand to start with, you're kind of, in essence, for lack of a better term, how many more metaphors can I put in there? you're putting your foot in your mouth if you don't have a good brand or creating a barrier, so to speak.
So there is, you allude to, or maybe you mentioned specifically some tools that you probably use or you use in the course of building your personal brand and helping clients build their brands too, or at least advising them. Are there some things that we can use like immediately out of the gate that you think would be really good tools to help build brands?
Immediately out of the gate, the one tool that everybody has, and I would say most people understand, is LinkedIn. And LinkedIn truly was built on the concept of helping people do business with one another. So if you are not utilizing LinkedIn, that's one huge mistake that you're making in terms of your own personal visibility. And the shocking fact is, I just read an article in the New York Times this morning that a large portion of women are not utilizing LinkedIn. They're not putting themselves out there.
So what would you say, Francis? Because when you say LinkedIn, I just immediately think, okay, well, I'm going to the wall, whatever it's called on LinkedIn, and I'm looking at the different posts, and I'm join a couple of groups, and I post some things up on their pulse or whatever the new pulse is now called. I don't know.
Yeah.
And I share some of the content that's out there, and I read, and I so what? Help me be more specific about what does LinkedIn do for you as a tool? Because I think that we all have access to it. So what do we do now?
So the one thing that LinkedIn does that is helpful from a business perspective is it puts all of your information out there and allows you to craft the message. You know, on your LinkedIn page, you have the choice of a photograph. That makes a difference. You have a choice of what you put in your bio. That makes a difference. Mm-hmm. And what people tend to do most often, that I see most often, is they had to create a LinkedIn page because they were going through a job search or their current employer told them to. So they just slapped up a picture up there. They said what they currently did in their life and left it and didn't bother to think about, you know, changing it, updating it, making sure that it's actually doing something for them rather than just being noise out in the world. Right. And that's the huge mistake that a lot of people make. I get a lot of traction through my LinkedIn because of the content that I put up on LinkedIn through the article function that is on there. That has driven a tremendous amount of traffic to me over the years. And it's a function that a lot of people stay away from because they fear it in some sort of way. You know, it really is putting yourself out there, but it's a great way to put yourself out there because you're putting something out there in a professional setting. And it dials right back to your professional profile, which does nothing more than to serve you in a positive way. And so it's really all of the functions of LinkedIn, I think, are highly unutilized by people.
I noticed that you're in a number of different channels. So you use Facebook, you use LinkedIn, you use I think you said Instagram a little bit earlier that you use. You're posting on a blog. You write your own personal blog. You have the video program that you're on as well. Is there one specific one that you would lean more into if you were advising your clients, or is it going to be specific to a client, or is there go in the new direction, the direction that trends are heading in, or do you go in the comfort zone? I remember when we connected through Skype initially, you clicked on the video. I didn't because I'm more of an audio guy. You clicked on video because I could see your video. Tell me what advice you give to somebody that's just signing up with you and trying to figure out what to do.
Well, it really is industry and goal specific. Not all platforms are appropriate for all industries. For example, I just had a meeting with an attorney up in New York City the other day, and he was like, "Do I need to be on Instagram? My daughter loves Instagram." And I'm like, "No, you do. Let's keep you on. You know, you are a very well respected judge, and I mean attorney, and well respected within your industry. Let's keep you off Instagram for a little bit, mostly because you don't have any visual content right now to share. So that would not be a place for him to go. But I have other clients who are athletes or entertainers, and they have tons of photographs and video, which makes them perfect for, for Instagram, not really such a need for LinkedIn because of their industry, even though they do happen to have LinkedIn profiles. My personal preference is Instagram. I love it because Instagram really, in my opinion, Instagram truly gets at the heart of the American attention span.
With their story building, it's like, okay, it's only going to be here for like what is it, 24 hours, the stories stay alive, and then if you don't have them, you're gone.
So I frequently advise clients that, because social media is such a visual medium, that when somebody is looking at your social media, they really should be viewing your narrative. And you should be crafting the content and the information that you're putting out there as if you are creating a story for people to view on your site. And I really think that really helps people connect with your brand in an authentic way that allows them to connect with you sooner.
I think the issue is that the people always look at it and say, I don't know really where my what direction my brand is supposed to go, or what is, other than having a good reputation, how do I build my brand? I mean, we are not, for most of the companies, I'm assuming that you do a lot of small, medium-sized businesses, unless you tell me that you're working with multi-million dollar organizations. Isn't it true that we all just are trying to figure out where our brand is supposed to go and then just kind of pivot when we need to pivot?
Exactly. And the starting the brand or where the brand should go is one of the biggest hangups that a lot of my clients have. And I break it down for them to, you don't work with a financial planner without a plan. You know, you don't start a workout regimen without a plan. Your brand is the same way. We really need to sit down and discuss, who are you today? Where do you want to go? And if there is a destination in mind that isn't quite you right now, how do we build content or build you towards your future self? I work with a lot of aspiring athletes, and, you know, they're young, they're just starting out, and they barely know who they are, let alone how they're going to project themselves to the world. And so a lot of my conversation with those young men and women starts around, okay, who are you right now? And tell me a little bit about where you aspire to be in the future. And as things come and go from your life, we will pivot your message to flow in accordance to what you're doing. I mean, look, Coke, for example, how many times in Coke's existence have they pivoted? Have they changed their tactic? Tons. Why? Because people's opinions are always changing. You know, consumer behavior is always changing. And I'm not saying that we are Coke, but we kind of are. And as you're telling your brand story, you have to realize that it is not a pot roast, that we don't create it one time, put it in the crock pot, and it just sits for the rest of your life. That this is a living, breathing mechanism, and that you are going to have to adjust and change and move to the changes in your life, the change in larger popular culture, and changes in your industry, because it's all about staying relevant. And so a big thing that I do with clients is sit down and say, okay, who are we today, but where do we want to be in the future? Because that's what we're working towards.
I think a lot of times it's challenging because we have in our head and in our hearts who we think that we are and who we want to be to our market and to those that are going to buy our products and services. And then we hear a message from our audience or from who we think is our market, and we're like, should I be me today, or should I be who my market wants me to be? So how do you answer a question like that? Who are we today?
I think authenticity is key. But I always tell a lot of my clients that authenticity, you have to be willing to be a little flexible with your authenticity.
Wait, is that possible to be that? A little flexible? Well, either you're authentic or you're not.
I'll throw my own self under the bus.
Sure, sure.
The real Frances that my friends and family know and occasionally love is so audacious, so chatty, so ridiculous that I would never get clients if I behaved that
way.
Yeah,
But you know what's funny? I saw you on your show, Let's Talk Personal. I saw you, and you were interviewing Jen Hecht from the Dating Advisory Board, who apparently, I guess, is a friend of yours also. So for just a moment, I saw, based upon some of the interviews that I was watching that you had done, and they're very professional, really good, but I thought, I don't see her yet. I'm not seeing her. And then when Jen came on, and you had the glass of rosé on the on the counter with you, and you even dropped a couple of four letter words, which I think was really good. You know,
which is very common for me in real life. Yes.
Okay, right. So I keep thinking, and again, somebody that's a brand ambassador for oneself, yeah. I always think, well, where was she? And believe me, I'm not taking anything away from your other content. I think it was great. But I'm like, I wanted that. Like, you had people come on the show and they were being their real selves and having a conversation with you. And I kept thinking, that sounds like a little bit like she's the brand expert rather than I want to see Frances for a moment. Just share Frances for a moment. Where's the girl that I saw a few minutes ago with the glass of rosé and Jen Hecht? And sometimes it's challenging. So I get what you're saying.
Right. There has to be many slices of yourself.
Yeah. Yeah.
And you can be authentic in all of those. You know, it sounds a little contradictory. So, you know, don't tweet at me, people. It's a little contradictory, but there are authentic versions of yourself. And you always have to keep your audience in mind. I do have a slice of my audience or a slice of my target market that loves Rosé Frances. You know, they live and breathe for it and they join right in with me. But I also have slices of my audience and potential clients who are very buttoned up and conservative and would be uncomfortable with someone who is very loose-lipped, if you will, managing their brand. So I walk a very fine line because I don't want people to assume that I am not competent enough to manage their brand because mine is wacky or crazy or whatever the case may be. And so, you know, my show, I tend to want to let my guests shine and let their brand come
totally
through.
Right. Totally right.
It's not about me. It's about them. If they pull me into their conversation, great. You know, my dad is a huge part of my radio show, which has become its own epic thing unto itself. But
oh yeah, we all have our cast of characters on our show, and we pull them along through this process as well. It's funny.
Right.
Sometimes they pull us along.
But you know, for those who know me in real life, me weaving my dad into the narrative of my radio show, to them, that seems very natural because my dad has always been a huge part of my brand. He's hilarious and interesting and wacky, and he's always been part of my brand story as a professional. So bringing him into the show was pretty much a no-brainer, and he kind of forced himself in anyway, so it kind of worked out. But on the show, I tend to want to let my guests shine, but I try to walk a very fine line of showing the various factions of my personality, but really I do try to keep it as professional as possible because I say this to clients all the time, especially professional athletes, look, you have your base, the people you grew up with, the people that know you, that you are catering to in your narrative, but you have this big, gigantic world of people who don't know you, and you don't want to offend them or push them away by keeping your brand in one place. Your brand needs to be approachable and open to whomever wants to come your way. And so I try to keep my brand as approachable to the left, right, up, down, as humanly possible. And it is a balance. It really is a balance.
I love how you have one of the questions I ask you on the Q&A before coming on the show is you be the podcast host for a second. If you had a podcast, what would you name it? And you said, well, I do. It's called Let's Talk Personal, and that's the show that you have. But I love the second one, and it really does bring up my next question to you is the second idea that you had is a show called All Business is Personal. So the reality of business, especially in our world, in my world, I can attest to the same thing. I really do get on a personal level with all of my clients, and they know everything about what goes on in my life, whether it's good, bad, or indifferent. Unfortunately, that's just I wear my emotions on my sleeve, and that's how I am. All business is personal. So chat about that for just a quick second before we wrap, just about how that is the reality in branding as well. All business is personal.
I mean, I live this and breathe this every day with myself, with my clients. Every business transaction is personal, and how you interact with people in every business transaction is personal. Whether you're emailing somebody, interacting with a fan through social media, giving a presentation, appearing on a podcast, what have you, you know, we always like to say, well, what happens is work is work and personal is personal. But we are slowly no longer living in that world anymore. Yeah. And we are now living in a world where you say something or do something and you don't get an opportunity to edit or and take it back.
It's interesting about that is it doesn't matter the size of your company either. Mm-mm. You could be an individual or you could be a company that, or you could be the president. I mean, look what the president is doing with social media. Look at what companies like Southwest and Uber are doing through yes. social media, you know, good, bad, or indifferent. It is coming back to haunt you or to help you. Yes. So there is no way to get away from traveling the lines between business and personal. It seems to be a very, very fuzzy line between those two things.
Well, and the one thing that is really biting people in the ass, and I've actually had people call me, personal friends call to ask what to do, is people being jerks to someone in a meeting, in an email exchange, and that person taking to social media or another platform to basically come at that person for, mm-hmm. for being a jerk. You know, hey, you promised that you would donate money to this charity and then you didn't. What's up with you? These kinds of things. And so now people are for good, bad, or indifferent, people are starting to drag things that normally would have been kept behind closed doors. People are dragging it into a public forum. And that's why I say all business is personal and we are all in the business of reputation management.
Francis, what would be an ideal client for you? And in doing that, also share with how people would get in touch with you if they were interested in finding out more about your services.
An ideal client for me is really an athlete, celebrity, or executive. And that can be at any stage of their career, who is really wanting to grow their brand and really is dedicated to the process of building and creating the content that would be needed to get them from one place to the other. People can literally find me everywhere. I almost get sick of myself sometimes. They can go to my website at www.yourfirestarter.com. They can find me on Twitter at @yourfirestarter. They can find me on Instagram at @firestarterceo. They can find me on Facebook.
we're gonna add all of Francis's contact information in the show notes. Or you know what? Just Google her.
Yeah, she will just come up. Literally Google me, and an entire page of my nonsense will come up. But that's my business. That's what I do. And
Francis, I keep Googling you. All I keep getting is porn stars. I don't know what.
Well, wait, I mean, well, if you can't beat them, join them. I say. It's really. I mean, I'm not even kidding when I say that a former client thought I was a stripper because there was a woman who worked at a strip club in Tampa who he swore was my doppelganger. And he was like, I mean, he literally grilled me for 45 minutes being like, where were you on this date? What were you doing on this date? And I'm like, dude, I was not. I'm not that stripper.
I'm pretty sure that you had a stalker. Right? I'm not quite sure that person was being legit with you.
I'm like, I was not that woman. But thank you. But I'm not that woman.
Excellent. Well, her show is called Let's Talk Personal. It actually can be found on letstalkpersonal.com. Her company is Firestarter, and that is at yourfirestarter.com. Is that where you can do that? Okay, excellent. And we'll put all of our contact information right there in the show notes. Francis, thank you so much for being a part. I apologize. Nice Guy Community, you not be aware of this, but we have had a scad of technical issues causing us to record actually four times. Fortunately, not having to repeat all the information, but if it sounds like there's a bit of Girl from Ipanema going on in the background, Nice Guy Community, you'll understand what that is. Francis, I apologize. That's just the music that we use when things go bad. So Nice Guy Community, never underestimate the power of nice. Special thanks to Francis Reimers for being a part of the show today. Steve O'Brien, go ahead and take us out of here.
For the Nice Guys on Business, I'm Steve O'Brien. Seriously, it'll only hurt for a minute. And don't worry, I'll be fine.